From the JAMA Network, this is JAMA Oncology Author Interviews. Conversations with authors exploring the latest clinical research, reviews, and opinions featured in JAMA Oncology.
Hello, and welcome to JAMA Oncology Podcast. I am Vivek Subbiah, medical oncologist and chief of early phase drug development at the Sarah Cannon Research Institute, Nashville, Tennessee. And I'm also the web editor for JAMA Oncology. Today, it is my pleasure and honor to host Dr. Michelle Rengarajan, a physician scientist from Harvard Medical School. She has published in JAMA Oncology on identification of immune checkpoint inhibitor-induced diabetes. Welcome, Dr. Rengarajan, to this podcast. So can you please introduce yourself?
Thank you so much for having me. My name is Michelle Rengarajan. I'm an endocrinologist and a physician scientist at Mass General Hospital in Boston.
So can you please give us an overview of your study and major findings?
We have been, along with a lot of other people at our institution, have been very interested in thinking about the checkpoint inhibitor toxicities and how they relate to spontaneous autoimmunity. And can the relationships there help us identify patients who are at higher risk for toxicities that might help oncologists better inform the clinical decision-making around some of these really powerful agents? As an endocrinologist, I thought it would be extremely useful to look at this in checkpoint inhibitor-induced diabetes, in part because we have so many tools available to us when we think about patients who have spontaneous type 1 diabetes. And we think about a number of different tools to try to phenotype those patients and understand what the course of their disease will look like. Whereas because checkpoint inhibitor-induced diabetes is so rare, it can be really hard to decipher more general patterns about the disease. So we were not the first people to try to do this, but we leveraged an extremely extensive data set, really spearheaded by Carrie Reynolds here at MGH, that collects data from every patient in our hospital system who is treated with immune checkpoint inhibitor diabetes. And so that allowed us to look at a comprehensive data set of over 14,000 patients who have been treated with checkpoint inhibitors over the last 10 years and look at the incidence of checkpoint inhibitor-induced diabetes in those patients. And then among the patients who had ICI diabetes, look at some of the different features that we think of as characteristic of spontaneous type 1 diabetes and compare that to the patients that we were seeing. And we were able to find some genetic links between type 1 diabetes and checkpoint inhibitor diabetes that I think we'd really like to see future work with larger data sets, but I think really point to some potential risk factors for this incredibly devastating complication of these extraordinarily powerful anti-cancer agents.
Dr. Rengarajan, so in your analysis, how does the incidence and prevalence of immune checkpoint-induced diabetes mellitus observed in your study compared to immune-related adverse events associated with immune checkpoint inhibitor treatments?
In our study, we found that immune checkpoint inhibitor diabetes is rare. So we saw it in 0.45% of the patients we looked at. So that was 65 patients out of over 14,000 total who were treated with ICI. And that ends up being an incidence that's about 7 to 8 times higher than spontaneous type 1 diabetes in that patient population. So it seems there's very clearly a dramatic increase in risk with checkpoint inhibitors, but it's still a rare IRAE. And I think this is in contrast with, for instance, checkpoint inhibitor-induced thyroiditis, which estimates range from 10 to 30% of patients treated, particularly with PD-1 inhibitors. So that's much more common. And other IRAEs like checkpoint inhibitor colitis are also more common than diabetes.
Can you elaborate on why pre-existing type 2 diabetes and combination immune checkpoint therapy are significant risk factors for developing immune checkpoint-induced diabetes?
Yeah, I can speculate. So I think the combination immunotherapy, so that's patients treated with a CTLA-4 inhibitor and either PD-1 or PD-L1 inhibitor, that has been shown to be an increased risk of IRAEs kind of across the board. And the explanation for that is that we're really taking out two major T-cell checkpoints with combination therapy. And so it's not so surprising that we would see higher incidences of autoimmune-like side effects from that. The pre-existing type 2 diabetes as a risk factor is a little trickier and certainly more specific to diabetes, but patients with type 2 diabetes have a number of possible contributing factors here. So there's some evidence that patients with type 2 diabetes have some pre-existing beta cell dysfunction and may have decreased beta cell mass. And so if you take that patient population and then you give them an immunologic hit to that reduced beta cell capacity, they may be more sensitive to a smaller hit than a patient without any pre-existing beta cell dysfunction or beta cell loss.
Also, your study mentions the use of a type 1 diabetes polygenic score as a predictor for immune checkpoint-induced diabetes. Could you explain the potential clinical applications of this genetic risk score in the context of immune checkpoint inhibitor therapy?
Absolutely. So this was the result we were really excited about and came from our close collaboration with Aaron Deutsch and Miriam Adler's groups. So the type 1 polygenic risk score is a polygenic risk score that is used to predict the likelihood of a patient having type 1 diabetes. And it is an exceptionally strong predictor for type 1 diabetes outside of the context of checkpoint inhibitor exposure. We actually took a subset of patients for whom tumor genotyping had been performed on the OncoPanel platform. And Aaron Deutsch then imputed germline genetic information in those patients and calculated their type 1 polygenic risk score. And we found that patients with a high type 1 polygenic risk score were far more likely to develop immune checkpoint inhibitor diabetes than patients with lower scores. And we think this is really interesting for two reasons. So the first is, we extracted this information from OncoPanel data. And of course, we would want to test this in much larger cohorts. But you can imagine that looking at this pre-existing genetic score might help to stratify patients based on their risk of type 1 diabetes. And particularly as we think about immune checkpoint inhibitors moving into the adjuvant and neoadjuvant settings, incorporating a patient's risk of this really devastating complication of therapy into clinical decision-making could actually be quite powerful. I just have to share, as an endocrinologist, I also think this raises a really interesting question, which is, if these are patients who have very high risk of type 1 diabetes, why didn't they get type 1 diabetes until they got checkpoint inhibitors? And so I think, conversely, it also might teach us something about patients who potentially have some protective features that prevented them from getting diabetes until they were treated with T-cell checkpoint inhibitors.
Fascinating point of view from an endocrinologist point of view. So what, in your opinion, are key clinical markers that physicians, especially oncologists, you know, who treat patients with immune checkpoint inhibitors, you know, what should they monitor in patients undergoing immune checkpoint therapy to identify early signs of immune checkpoint inhibitor-related diabetes mellitus, especially in those patients with pre-existing risk factors?
That's a great question. I think I would like to see more reliable measurements of hemoglobin A1C going into checkpoint inhibitor therapy. Not that that would change your decision-making, but just to get a sense of, is this someone with pre-existing type 2 diabetes or pre-existing insulin resistance that might put them at higher risk? And then something that I see clinically quite frequently is almost all of these patients are getting pretty regular glucose checks, because every time they get a metabolic panel, they're getting a glucose that's checked. But I think often those glucoses can be quite hard to interpret. And so when someone comes in with hyperglycemia, it's easy to conclude that it's because they just ate right before, or that that's not an accurate measurement. But I think we, as sort of a field, can do a little bit of a better job of actually paying attention to those glucose measurements and kind of tracking, is this someone where that blood sugar on the metabolic panel is creeping up? The other thing we could think about is tracking things like fasting sugar, so getting those labs fasting, so we're really comparing a robust fasting glucose measurement over the course of therapy, or continuing to track that hemoglobin A1C in patients at risk. The downside of that is it's going to be a little bit of a slower responder. And I think some patients who come in with really acute immune checkpoint inhibitor diabetes do not actually have markedly elevated hemoglobin A1Cs when they come in, suggesting that this is a little bit of a faster process. But I think a couple things. The first is measuring a hemoglobin A1C prior to treatment to get a better sense of an individual patient's risk. And the second is potentially in a patient who is particularly high risk, incorporating a more routine fasting glucose measurement into their lab and looking for more subtle rises in their blood glucose that might suggest that something is changing. And then the last thing I would say is some of these patients present quite acutely. And just knowing that they have high risk of checkpoint inhibitor-induced diabetes means the response to that acute presentation might be faster. So I think having a clear idea of patient risk at the outset is important to keep in mind.
This is very important for all the oncologists and healthcare providers who are treating patients with multiple cancers with immune checkpoint inhibitors. So as an endocrinologist, what would be your advice for oncologists on the long-term management strategies for patients who develop immune checkpoint-induced diabetes mellitus, considering the irreversible nature of this condition?
I think there's two big arms to think about in terms of long-term management. So the first is, what do you do with the immune checkpoint inhibitor? And the second is, how do we manage the new diabetes? And so first, our perspective and guidelines are there's not, from a diabetes perspective, we don't think there is any benefit to stopping immune checkpoint inhibitors. With the data we have now, I tend to believe that most patients should be continued on their immune checkpoint inhibitor, and then we treat the diabetes that has emerged. And toward that end, the first thing I would say is it's really important to manage these patients in very close collaboration with a diabetes endocrinologist and ideally in a specialized center. Ultimately, these patients are going to be managed the same as most of our patients with type 1 diabetes. And that was actually a surprise to us in the study. So part of why we did the study was that we had hypothesized we might see different phenotypes of immune checkpoint inhibitor diabetes that might result in slight differences in management. But ultimately, when we looked at one-year follow-up data, we found that regardless of the details of the initial presentation, most of the patients ultimately required the same management. And that's basal and mealtime insulin management. And I would say that's a field that's rapidly changing in the world of diabetes in general, but working in close collaboration with the diabetes endocrinologist, making sure these patients are on a good basal bolus insulin regimen, and then sort of exploring other ways to deliver that insulin alongside a specialized diabetes center is, I think, the best management for these patients.
What are the next steps for research in this area? Are there any ongoing or planned prospective studies to validate the risk factors and genetic predictors identified in your study?
You know, we talked earlier about the prevalence of immune checkpoint inhibitor diabetes and that it's rare. And so I think as we think about this particular IRAE, we really need to be thinking about very large multi-center collaborations in prospective studies, because we would love to be looking at much higher numbers of patients with ICI diabetes so that we can really do more powerful genetic analyses of these patients and also get really more rigorous approaches to really hone in on what the risk factors are. I think in an ideal world, clinically, we would be able to see a patient coming into clinic who is getting checkpoint inhibitor therapy and stratify their risk of ICI diabetes and monitor them accordingly. And that's really something we would like to do for IRAEs across the board. Thinking prospectively around diabetes in particular, we really need large multi-center efforts to create large enough data sets of these patients to be able to do that. I'm sort of watching my colleagues in other fields looking at this in other IREs as well, like myocarditis, colitis, which can be quite severe, and where I think the sort of obvious comparison to spontaneous disease is a little bit less clear. But I think really moving forward is generating much larger prospective data sets that allow us to really validate some of the risk factors that we've proposed in this work could be quite powerful.
Wow, wonderful. And congratulations on your work. To our broad listeners at JAMA Oncology, we've been listening to Dr. Michelle Rengarajan on the paper, Identification of Immune Checkpoint Inhibitor-Induced Diabetes. This episode was produced by Shelley Stephens at the JAMA Network. To follow this and other JAMA Network podcasts, please visit us online at jamanetworkaudio.com. Thank you so much for listening.